thank you for joining Auto Network Reports. I'm your host, Roosevelt. Hope you brought your coffee along. This is our coffee and cars presentation. And we have today Mr. Dave Boldt, TexGarage.com, hanging out in Herndon, Virginia, as usual. Mr. Greg Morrison, Bumper to Bumper TV out of Atlanta, and Miss Teia Collier Blackshear out of, where are you hanging out today? I don't know where she's hanging out, and she doesn't either. She didn't respond. Dallas, Texas. Well, we're going to have, hopefully, a different kind of show today. We're going to talk a little bit about where we've been in the past few weeks, and we've been a lot of different places, and come to find out, I thought Dave was teasing me about a week ago, saying that he was in Maui, and he was in Maui, and we were in, and Greg and I were in Kona. So, but anyway, we've been all over the place in the past few weeks, but want to get some PSA announcements out of the way. If you know an African-American male that's 30 years or older, please, please, please make sure he visits his urologist and get that PSA exam. It's that little prick that can possibly save his life. And we're getting Tia's laundry room background noise again, so would you mute yourself? Please subscribe to each one of the panelists, either their Facebook page or their websites. Show them some love. We try to do this once a week, Wednesdays, 10 a.m. As you know, we used to do Thursdays at 3 p.m. And for some reason, I'm finding it hard to get up on Wednesday morning to get ready to do a 10 a.m. show. I don't know about you guys. But Greg, talk a little bit about our trip to Kona, the products that were shown. We had the new Tacoma, as well as the Grand Highlander.
Roosevelt, can you back up just a minute?
And Greg's muted, but go ahead. Go ahead, Dave.
For those of us that don't travel, could you give Kona some context on the map? I know that there's a Kona bicycle and there's a Kona coffee.
We're talking about Kona, Hawaii.
Oh, Hawaii.
Well, you know, you were on one of the big islands.
Well, and I was on the island personally. It was a personal trip, and I have the credit card receipts to prove it. You guys show me some credit card receipts, and I'll believe you were on Kona, okay?
Yeah, okay, Greg.
Would you take my credit card receipt from when I bought a bunch of Kona coffee while I was on the island?
That works. Absolutely.
Actually, the Kona trip was a twofer for a lot of us. We did two vehicles. And normally when you do on these trips, you know, you go in one day, you sleep two nights in a hotel, and then you're out. This time I got in Monday and didn't leave until Friday and was fighting it all the way back to the airport because I wanted to stay another week. But the fun aside, we did get a chance to get some seat time in the Toyota Grand Highlander, which is an extended version of the Highlander with more room and more technology and more interesting drivetrain since they're really pushing toward electrification. We also got a chance to get a first look at, but not drive, the 2024 Tacoma from Toyota, which is a game changer for this brand. We all know that in that small mid-sized truck segment, it's getting ugly in terms of competition. And Toyota says, oh, don't worry, we're coming back with something to meet it all. And they have, including a Trail Hunter edition for serious off-roading. And thank God, somebody at Toyota finally figured out that the passenger side in the front needed some more footwell space so that your knees aren't in your teeth. So they get a big ups from me for that. Looking forward to driving the vehicle. We didn't get a chance to put any seat time in it, but it looks very impressive. They've really thought about ergonomics and technology in this offering, the Tacoma. Roosevelt and a few others and myself, we posted our reviews on the Grand Highlander last night at 5:30 Eastern time. So go to our websites, whether it's Bumper to Bumper TV or, you know, Dallas Single Mother's Drive or whatever, and check out what we thought of the vehicle.
Yeah, I was mentioning in the green room to Dave all the video that I shot of the week in Hawaii, especially the Grand Highlander. And since the Tacoma embargo was broken by somebody in the media.
Not me.
Toyota was not a happy camper because they had kept all the Dakota information under wraps until the day before the announcement was to go live and somebody broke the embargo. So the plus side for me was I had an opportunity to live stream the Tacoma presentation from Kona, which if you watch the video now, it looked like it went well, but it was kind of shaky for the actual live presentation.
Yeah, when it hit, running out of bandwidth out there, everybody and their brother playing up their smartphone.
Exactly.
At the same time.
But when you look at the video now, it's nice and smooth and clear. And we had, you know, we didn't have the, I was a little disappointed that we didn't have the hula dancers, but they did have fire knife twirlers.
Over on Maui, we have hula dancers and we had a wait staff that was shirtless. So top that. Yeah, and I've got the receipts to prove it.
So, and we did have the luau,
But Dave, we were able to see you because from where our hotel was, we could actually see the island of Maui. We waved a few times, but no one waved back.
Yeah, that's extraordinary, Greg. Thank you.
So, Teia, what event have you been on recently?
I went to Mama Rally, actually, in Wisconsin.
Okay.
So, isn't that great?
Oh my gosh. Yeah. I love Road America, and that is a fantastic trip. Like, they do a really good job with that. And okay, so this year there was like an extended off-road course. So last year there was just the green one. This year there was a blue and a green one. The blue one, it was real life. There were all these trees, all these rocks. they kept magically appearing. And I fell in love with a couple vehicles that I hadn't driven yet. So that was my first time driving a Bronco Raptor. Like, if you're going to be off-roading, living your life outside, amazing. And also the Nissan Pathfinder. Like, it doesn't look like it's as capable as it is. But then you get in it and you drive it like that. I'd only driven it on the street. I hadn't driven it on an off-road course. And I was like, well, B. Okay. And I kept looking at it thinking, they wouldn't set me up to fail. They wouldn't set me up to fail. They wouldn't set me up to have to be pulled out of some hole by the Jeep rally guys. And they were looking too. And they had their, like, you know, their trucks with their winches on it. They were just kind of watching me take it over. Nobody said, don't do this. Okay. They did. And he watched me walk over there. I got in it. And then when I came out, he goes, I was like, I earned the seal of approval from the Jeep guy. I was proud of myself.
Tia, was this your first trip to Wisconsin?
It wasn't. This is my second. I only did track last year. I really didn't do off-road. I did track. And it was my first time doing autocross last year.
Well, those were not rocks that you were traversing on the off-road. Those were blocks of aged cheese.
No, but I did have cheese curds for the first time, like the fried ones. Those were amazing. And I was like, I need these in my life, more of these. And I kept trying to find them multiple places. And they're like, okay, you've got to get a life. But
you must have gained like a pound while you were.
I did. It was wonderful.
My only question is, after all this descriptive of what you went through in the car, did you need a cigarette afterwards?
So I actually rode with another one of our automotive journalists, and I am a daisy off-roader, right? Like, I'm that one that drives 2 miles an hour. That's me. And I was like, you are tailgating me. You are literally tailgating. Got in the car, rode with somebody else, and I was like, oh, okay.
You needed a cigarette.
Need a cigarette or a cocktail or both. I was like, okay. We're
okay,
good.
Let's get away from our great events because we seem to be getting a little carried away. Go ahead, Dave.
Roosevelt, can I mention, not only was I on Maui and have receipts to prove it, but I was able to rent a 2022 Grand Cherokee whose review is at Texas Garage, txgarage.com. as we speak.
So that's one I loved. Yeah. I fell in love with that one.
Since you are talking about what you've driven, Dave, talk a little bit about what press car you had, if you had one.
Well, I was going to say on Maui, I rented a 2022 Grand Cherokee. It came to about $470 for the week. But frankly, as Grand Cherokee owners, was very, very impressed with this one. The last time I was in the GC was the 4xe version, which I think retailed for something like $65. This was more like a $52,000 Grand Cherokee Limited, and I can get my head around that $52,000, or in vacation vernacular, $470 a week, better than I could get my head around the 4xe at like $65,000. But anyway, very, very nice Jeep. And if we were to replace our 06 ever, it would be with the idea that maybe we put the 2023-2024 on our shortlist this week. Well, I'm driving a 330i xDrive BMW, which coincidentally is also in the mid-50s. And it was satisfactory. I was hoping to say I was excited by it. I don't think I was excited, but it was very, very satisfactory. And it was nice to get into that BMW sphere again after a few years of having not been in it.
Great. Greg, how about you?
Well, this week has been an interesting week. I had a chance to get some seat time in the Mazda CX-90. I took it on a road trip to Mobile, Alabama, and was pleasantly surprised with the 31 miles to the gallon I was getting on the open road. Going, wait a minute, this is an inline. This is a big honking sucker. And yet, on the highway, it did quite well. The interior really impressed me, especially when you're looking at the detail and the quality of the interior feel.
Teia, excuse me, Greg. Teia, mute yourself, please. Thank you.
Yeah. And the plenty of room, third row had more room than I expected, which was a wonderful experience. At the same time, the folks at Nissan were gracious enough to send me an Aria. So I took that over to my friends at the Weather Channel because they are EV crazy. And we spent most of the morning giving them basically EV 101 class. So there'll be an article posted on the Weather Channel's website probably this week sometime, sort of going into more detail on it. The most fun is when I get Jordan and Stephanie, the host of Patterns, into the EV, and we went driving around the neighborhood, and I told them, punch it, see the reaction on their face, and their eyes got real big when they saw that electric response and so forth. We even had some of the senior executives from the Weather Channel coming up, wanting to know more, and I pointed out to them that, yeah, you've got charging stations here, but they're only for Teslas. What about the rest of the industry? And they're going, oops, we're going to fix that.
Well, good. Good. Did you have a cigarette afterwards?
No, man. I went with a stogie, brother.
I think in my list of things to talk about after we review some cars is that Tesla is going to open up their superchargers to other manufacturer EVs. So I think, yeah, they're going to start with Ford, but I think they even said in the past they're going to open up to everybody, but I believe Ford worked out a deal where Ford is going to be the one that they start with. So it's going to be interesting to see how well Tesla does in one area that I think we've talked about before, and that's charger maintenance. And since now they will be obviously getting more people using their chargers on a regular basis, so it's going to see if they have a maintenance program in place to keep those chargers going like they've been going with just Tesla users. So, Teia, what are you driving?
I was in the Chrysler Pacifica hybrid and now the Nissan Z. So I think hybrids are the gateway drug for people to this EV adoption, particularly those plug-in hybrids. People need practice doing it. Even if it's not a lot of miles, even if it's less than 50, people need practice using the technology and working it into their day. I loved that thing. Like, absolutely loved it. It's got space. It's got ports for everybody. It's got air conditioning. I don't have to listen to what they're listening to in the back seat. You know, you can just live your life. It's your family hauling. Mm-hmm.
Does it have a washer dryer?
It has a vacuum cleaner. No washer dryer, but a vacuum cleaner.
They're working on a washer and dryer.
I can't even hear where it is. Like, I've got headphones on, so I can't hear. I hear y'all, but I can't hear anything else. Yeah. It's wonderful. That And they've got this thing called the Calm Cabin. Okay, so if you have kids or someone who has special needs, a sensory disorder, they have a Calm Cabin. So it has all the stuff. Up till now, family's been making stuff up, right? You've been winging it, putting together these kits, these sensory kits, to make travel so much more comfortable and easy with families, either if your child's on the spectrum or if your child has a sensory delay. It's got things in it that makes life easier. So you've got your weighted blanket, you've got your sound modification, you've got the strap that keeps the seatbelt from rubbing into their skin and digging in and leaving marks. All the stuff we've been making as parents, making up stuff, creating these kits for ourselves, Chrysler took the step to say, hey, look, we got you. Okay, we're going to put it together. We're going to make a nice package. It's tested, it's sound, and we're here for you. I love that. Okay, it says, hello, yeah, you're going to get my money, but you're going to get lots more of my money. It's basically what that says to me, and that we actually care. It's game changing. It's game changing. It's one of those things, because a lot of families that have special needs children don't travel. They stay within their neighborhoods because it's really complicated to get in, get from point A to point B, point C. It opens up the world to you, and love that. Now, that's the Pacifica. Adore it. The Z has been on my crush list for years. Okay. That thing rolled up yesterday. The storms literally had stopped raining so that it could roll up to my house. I looked outside. I was like, it's like this sapphire blue, and it is insane. Okay. I was just like, okay, love my life. But that's where I'm at. I've only had it for like less than a day, so I don't even know. All I've done is just drive up and down my street, and my neighbors are probably sick of me already, but don't even care. Not really, well, I kind of care, but like not a lot yet.
Roosevelt, could you remind Teia that we're here to provide objective journalism, objective automotive perspective?
Yeah. Well, I won't get into plug-in hybrids, because you all know how I feel about plug-in hybrids. But I did experience the Z, and I had the Z for a week, and I had the opportunity to drive down in Greg's area, the Atlanta area, with the Z. And all I can say is it's a great looking automobile. It performs like it's supposed to perform. But once you reach a certain age and you're going to be in that seat for a few hours, the Z is a trophy car that you bring out on the weekends for the older folk to show off, like Kia, driving it up and down the street, and then you park that sucker. but if you're like three of us on this panel right now, in our age group, if you jump in that car and drive the different road surfaces for 3.5 hours, You unfold yourself to get out of it. And once you snap the spine to get back where you can stand up straight, you say, okay. They swapped in Atlanta with a GLC Mercedes 300. So that's what I drove home in. And you talking about a blast, a contrast. Ooh. In comfort. Mm-hmm. No, yeah. Comparison.
It's been
one thing. It's mandatory. Is you have to take the fitness program first.
Yes.
So you can, you know, coil yourself in and out of it. It is not for those of us of a certain age or a certain size. But once you get in there, you got to admit, driving it is a boatload of fun.
It's a blast.
And when you get out there, on all fours.
You do wish there was more of a grand touring aspect to cars like the Z. My wife and I think it's been 2 years ago, we took Subaru's BRZ, which is actually a more expansive cockpit than the Z. It's a 2+2. But we took it from LA to Palm Springs, which is maybe 2 hours. And based on the road surfaces between LA and Palm Springs on 10, it beat us up. It just drove us nuts. And it just occurred to me there was enough space, certainly enough performance, that why they don't build a GT spec of these cars so you and your significant other could go somewhere for a period of more than an hour would be a really nice thing to do. And I kind of wonder why they don't tap into that. we can afford these cars, so why aren't they building one for us? Buick doesn't need to do it. Nissan could do it. And thanks for listening.
Because they, always say we want to tap into the youth and the younger buyer. So when they're ready to be able to purchase, they will know about this automobile.
But they ought to sell them to people that are old enough to smoke.
Dave, that's why we don't get paid the big bucks.
As I adjust my headphones. So.
No, it's I must say, I have always loved the Z. I mean, I sold cars back in the day when the Z actually came out. So I can, you know, I've grown with the history of the Z. It's been a great automobile.
Were you one of the, to put it politely, were you one of the jerks, Roosevelt, that were charging $5,000 over MSRP on a $4,000 car?
Probably.
Well, thank you very much.
If you've ever sold cars, there is something called management. And there is something called look over your shoulder as you sell an automobile. Salespeople are never given the final say on the price of a car that they sell. Because if they were given that authority, they would give every car away to make the sale.
Uh-huh.
So, yes, if they said this is the price that is going to go out of the door, this is the price that is going to go out of the door. And I think you've probably heard the story of me talking about this. It was a doctor who wanted a Z so bad he came in and he just quoted these ridiculous prices that he wanted to buy the Z at. And management said, nope, let him walk. And he walked. We went round and around for a couple of months. He'd go all up the East Coast. Oh, Roosevelt, he called me. Roosevelt, I can get this Z for such and such a price. I said, Doc, are you driving it? He said, no. I said, then what are you talking about? Why are you calling me? When you buy one, drive by here so I can show the management that you got it at such and such a price. He never got one. He came back and finally said, okay, Roosevelt, what can I really get this car for? Yeah. Sold him a Z. Next week, he came by with a bottle of champagne. I said, Doc, you could have been enjoying this thing for over 2 months rather than putting yourself through all this grief.
Torture.
Yeah. Because if a new car dealer does not want to sell you a car at a ridiculous price, you cannot buy that car at that price anywhere in the United States if it's a franchise-owned new car. Right. That's just how the business works. Go ahead.
Well, I was going to ask, for those of you that have driven a Z, I look forward to renting one, maybe on Maui. But for those of you that have driven it, how do you compare it to the... I've been behind the wheel very briefly at a WAPA ride and drive. But how do you compare it to the Supra?
Oh, it's a different animal than the Supra.
Yeah. It feels very different than a Supra.
Is it more raw, less refined?
I think it would be less refined than a Supra.
I think it's less refined. I think it's not like the Supra feels kind of weighted, kind of like this. Uh-huh. The Z doesn't feel that way. It's fun and it's fast and it's got this element of oomph to it, but the Supra feels almost like it's hitting above its price point inside.
Difference ahead, to me,
Dave. I mean, Greg.
The Z was a car that we took it on the tail of the dragon. You realize the Z is more of a straight line car than the Supra.
Hmm.
And that, you know, you could handle all 380 semi turns, no problem. But you take the Supra or the BRZ out, whatever you want to call it, and it hit those curves. And because it was lighter and easier to handle, it hit those curves a lot, you know, with a lot more control. But in the straightaway, give me that Z every time. And all you're seeing is my exhaust and tail light. I'm gone.
Uh-huh. And I think the Z gives you more of what you would think of when you buy a sports car.
Mm-hmm.
And like we talked about the ride, the rough ride in the sports car is what you get in a sports car. Whether you're going to pay $100,000, $60,000, $150,000, you want, you know, sports car owners want to feel that.
You feel
that ride, and they want to feel the handling of the car itself. Mm-hmm. They're not looking for sedan ride comfort.
Right.
Or else they buy a sedan.
Right. Exactly.
when again, my exposure with the Supra is far more extensive. I've had both the 6 and the 4, but that is a car that I could envision leaving DC and doing a day trip into upstate New York.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas this BRZ, as an example, I could not. And my suspicion is if and when I can rent a Z, I'll experience the same thing. Yes.
Now, one of the things that I showed in my, I have a review of the Z because, like I said, I had it a week ago. There was no security cover in the Z. And if you notice, there's a huge, that hatch is practically all glass. So if you're going to pack, which is the only place you can pack luggage, if you have anything back there on a bright sunny day that might melt, trust me, it's going to melt because that sun beaming through that supposedly tinted glass heats up that storage area like you wouldn't believe. You know, I opened my duffel bag, and when you open the bag, you got a burst of heat. I opened my, you know, my travel case where you have your toothbrush and all that and vitamins. My gummy vitamins melted in the little case. Little things like that that you don't even think about until it happens to you. So
Thank you for the heads up before I do something like that.
If you're going to have one, make sure you have one with a security cover or be very conscious of what you're going to put back there when you're out driving on a bright sunny day. So
Yeti, I think, makes refrigerated coolers that will run for the car's electrical system. So maybe Nissan should be offering those.
I don't know, but you don't hear about, you know, talking about getting burned in Kona and Maui. You lay back there in the back of that storage space. It's like an oven. But anyway, moving right along. Any final comments before we take a break until next week?
Well, the one thing I would tell folks, we're getting ready to run up on, we're running up on the beginning of summer, 4th of July holiday and so forth. Please, 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 please do not drink and drive. Do not take any substances and drive. It's just not worth it. And just take your time to get there. You don't have to be first. I'd rather you get there and get home in one piece than worrying about being first and killing yourself or injuring yourself or somebody else.
And as we talk about rising summer temperatures and what you might put in back, keep in mind if you've got a kid in back, get the kid out of the car.
Or a pet.
Yeah, even if it's for a short period of time.
Right. And pets as well. Because car temperatures, it was amazing. Like the heat experience with the Z just showed me how hot a car gets just sitting out there with the engine not running and no air conditioning. And even in this situation, the engine was running and there was air conditioning, but you had, it was almost like a spotlight on, you know, of the sunlight just on the rear section of the car, the rear storage area. So you can drive 360 degrees. You're still going to get the same sun beaming on that same spot all that time. So, and it makes a difference in terms of the interior heat of the car. And I can understand why we're probably keep the air conditioning running in cars like that, mainly because of that heat buildup from that glass.
Right. So bring stuff.
Yes. But anyway, as always, folks, please buckle up. Don't drink and drive. Go ahead, Dave.
Roosevelt, can I ask one more question now that you and Greg are on?
Okay.
Could I send my food receipts from Maui to the Toyota folk with the idea that they reimburse me?
Yeah, they'd like to see them.
Or maybe send them to Jeep.
Yeah, right.
Okay, just ask.
But as always, please buckle up. Don't drink and drive, like Greg said. Buckle up, don't text and drive. As always, have fun and enjoy the weekend. See you next time.
Y'all be good.
Bye-bye.